2010 school board meeting. Would you please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance?
Pledge of Allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Adjustments to the agenda. I'm actually going to propose one of my own, which is for items 4 and item 9 to switch them. So we would have comments from the public on agenda items first, and then at the end of the meeting, public comment on non-agenda items. I think that makes more sense in terms of the flow of the meeting. So unless anyone objects to that, I'd like to make those changes. Okay. Alan, do you have any adjustments?
I do. For the communications plan, I had mistakenly not put it where it should be. Could we put the communication plan and have Mary do that under communications? That's a good place for it. It's number 6, communications, and make that A, so that would be the first one. And then B would be resignations, retirements, and so on down.
Okay, thank you. Anything else? No? Okay. All right, so first up is approval of the school board minutes. Do I have a motion?
I move for approval.
Of the 2000, yeah, okay. Close enough. Second?
Second.
All those in favor? Okay. Comments by student representatives.
I'm Rome Futak, and I'm Ashley Tinsman. First off, the mini-school dance on March 5th went well for the school. Great behavior. There was not a big turnup of 7th and 8th graders because of the track meet. 60% of the 7th and 8th graders did not like the dance. They said they did not like the theme, which was flashback. And the next dance will be held April 29th, which is the semi-formal.
And the 7th and 8th grade girls' basketball ended on March 3rd.
And the middle school spring sports registration started March 7th. And we'll end on the 19th, and the first spring sports practice is on April 5th.
Thoroughly Modern Millie, the school play, and the shows are on April 8th at 2:30, April 9th at 7, April 10th at 7, and April 11th at 2.
Spirit Week is coming up. Monday, March 15th is Twin Day. Tuesday will be Cape Color Day. Wednesday will be Clash Day. Thursday, Preppy Nerd Day, and Friday, Pajama Day.
March 10th at 7 p.m. in the high school auditorium is the all-choral night, middle and high school chorus.
April vacation starts Friday the 16th. Kids will be coming back, will be back in school on Monday the 26th.
On March 26th, parent/teacher conferences. Stephen Connolly, the principal, hopes to see lots of kids going to their conferences as well. Teachers' workshops in the afternoon. These conferences might be held a little later for the 7th and 8th graders.
Lily Jordan, recently a 7th grader, at Cape Middle School, recently won the Cumberland County Spelling Bee that was held at Harrison Middle School in Yarmouth. She will be advancing to the state spelling bee scheduled for March 20th at the Abramson Center on the USM Portland campus.
Senora Dana's 7th grade advisory group worked collaboratively to write an MSPA grant for transportation funding to go to Tu Casa, a Salvadorian restaurant on Monjoy Hill. They were awarded the grant and the group went on Friday, March 5th. Prior to going, they practiced restaurant and food vocabulary. At the restaurant, they spoke Spanish and ordered foods such as pupusas, traditional Salvadorian tortillas, and batidos, smoothies made with fresh fruit. Now they're going to design a menu or children's placemat in Spanish for Tu Casa.
March 18th, coming up, the basketball bonanza will take place in the middle school gymnasium, and the first game will be at 6:30.
And we had a disability awareness presentation, and people that came were Tyler, a man with autism, Pat, a woman who is blind, Laura, a woman with cerebral palsy, and Irene, a coordinator from Speaking Up for Us.
March into May walking program. We will be encouraging students to participate in a walking program at school and at home during the months of March, April, and May.
5210 is it's encouraging kids to eat at least 5 fruit and vegetables per day, 2 hours or less of recreational screen time, 1 hour or more physical activity, and 0 sugar or sweetened beverages.
At the 8th grade Valentine's dance, they sold smoothies to raise money for Haiti, and they raised more than $300.
In March 19th and March 26th is an early release and a teacher workshop in the afternoon.
And also, just a reminder, don't forget that March 14th is daylight savings time and to check the school blog. And that's all. Any questions?
That's a lot.
I actually have one. Understands, what if you're both preppy and a nerd? What do you go as? Wear a button-down shirt with a pocket protector?
I guess so.
Okay, thank you.
Welcome.
Thank you. Okay, the high school?
Yep. So we're basically in the middle of third quarter right now, so always sort of a grind between January and April, so hopefully we can get our way there. Winterfest is in 2 weeks, which everybody's looking forward to, I think, to break up sort of the rhythm of March. In terms of the budget, everybody's starting to really sort of talk about it, ask about getting involved, and hopefully tonight in the next couple of weeks will help in that category in terms of students speaking up and what they want, and also everybody understanding what exactly is going to happen. And then in terms of sports, we're pretty much in the middle of seasons right now. I believe every winter sport is closed out by now, and spring will start in a couple weeks.
On that budget note, kids are definitely talking about the meeting that the principals had with the teachers at the 3 different schools, and I think we're just trying to find a time to schedule when the kids can come and talk about their opinions about the budget and offer hopefully some helpful suggestions about where money could be saved without cutting too much value. But as usual, scheduling is difficult. Also, our Student Advisory Council has kind of taken on a new organizational structure. Ben Berman, our student body president, has broken us all into groups. We have the executive committee, which is all the presidents from the class, and then Matt and myself, and the climate committee, which works on like school spirit and the school environment, the curriculum committee and the extracurricular committee is kind of one together, and they are working on ways to improve the curriculum, and I think their biggest project is trying to organize a book that has all of the extracurricular activities in it, because I know definitely for underclassmen, it sometimes can be overwhelming. There's a lot going on in the high school. And then the policy committee, which talks about things like the substance abuse policy. So we are all getting going on those. I think all of the committees are meeting either this week or next week. And also, our next full SAC meeting is April 7th, and we all wanted to invite all the school board members to come. It is at 7:15 in the morning, so that may not be too encouraging, but we wanted to share kind of our work with you and talk about the budget. So I will send that out on an email, that date, but April 7th at 7:15.
All right. Thank you. Any questions? Okay. Comments from the public on agenda items. Okay. Moving on to recognition, the Middle School Career Fair volunteers.
Should have just asked the girls to keep it on going. Did a nice job. I was surprised to hear the dance didn't get good votes. Staff loved it.
That's probably why.
That's probably why. Okay. And I'm with you on the Clash Day stuff. I don't know. St. Patrick's Day is Clash Day? I guess I'll have to wear green and orange. Let's see here. For the career fair, we had probably, I don't know, maybe 25 total offerings for this the career fair that happened on January 4th. Our most recent, we had Officer Mark Dorville, Chief Peter Gleason. We had Lieutenant Mason Wilcox, Jack Guffey, Gwyneth McGuire, Dr. Mark Earnshaw. We also had Lynette Kirk Gordon, some guy named Tony Boffa, many of you may know, used to teach at the school as well. We had Priscilla Debris, Bob Hess, Marilyn Sinet, Greg Sinet, Kurt Brown, Adam Bacchus, Steve Price, our Steve Price, Abby Pierce, Stacy Koloski, Holly Seddon, Audrey Castro, Bib Jordan, Bill Banford, Jennifer Rooks, Dr. Patricia Chase, Glenn Jordan, Gibson Faye LeBlanc, Peter Carey, David Turin, and Sarah Lennon, who presented this year to our students. And it was everything from the U.S. military, technology careers, physicians, medical fields, engineering, biotech, marine tech, acting and theater, farming and agriculture, television, veterinarians, sports writing. It's a great activity. And it's all donated time by the people in the community. Gail Schmader and our guidance staff does an outstanding job of pulling together all of these volunteers to do this. It's a wonderful event. Usually Audrey whips up some really good tasting items as well, and the extras go into the teacher's room, so we're all right with that. So, and then David Turin this year from David, who is chef, he had some wonderful delicacies as well. So it's a really nice event, and it combines with the job shadow day that we do with students and with the guidance career paths units and the bridges technology piece that they do in grades 7 and 8. But the career fair is certainly one of the highlights of that whole event. So I'd like to thank everyone that participated, and certainly hope to see them back next year.
Thanks, Steve. Thanks. Any questions? And the very special arts contest winners.
I'll stay right here.
Right?
Okay. So I have several art awards. Marguerite Lala Rohner, as you all know, is a busy person. She's an identical twin, in case you didn't know. I'm a twin, she's a twin, but we're not to each other. So she does the job of two people at the same time. And one of the things that she has going, she submits a lot of works of students for contests because she likes the idea of authentic audiences. Instead of kids presenting work so that they can have it for a grade for Marguerite to evaluate, they're participating in contests so that the students have an interest other than just Ms. Lala Rohner's eye on their work. And so the first one that I have is March is Youth Art Month, and sixth grader Catherine Briggs is representing Cape Elizabeth Middle School at the Portland Museum of Art. She has a piece that's currently framed and on display there, and will be there from February 27th through April 4th. And here's a write-up that came from the museum. It says, this year the Portland Museum of Art is proud to celebrate 16 years of hosting Maine Art Education Association's annual Youth Art Month exhibition. This exhibition displays more than 100 works of art by students from around the state in recognition of the value and importance art education plays in Maine schools. It's a treat each year to make the special trip to the museum, so if you get an opportunity, there's a celebration and reception this Saturday, March 6th in the evening. And this is an example of the work. Sorry, I only have it on 8.5 by 11, but I'll just show it here. This is so that they can get a look at it. This is an example of the work that Catherine did that is on display there. It's actually done in torn small pieces of paper. It's a mosaic, and it's a fascinating piece. I think she entitled it Toad Island. And we also have, there's another national contest called Very Special Arts. And in the Very Special Arts, the motto of that is that all kids can create.
and it's a children's call for art that goes out nationally, and all the votes have been, are in and have been tallied, and what they do is select, they select two pieces from each state to go to be sent to Washington, D.C., and then from there, there's one winner from each state. I think our odds of being the one winner from the state are good because this is the first year they've actually had two pieces come from the ones from one school. So here is a piece by Beck Hamlin. This is called The World of Chaos. And then the next piece is called The Lazy Dog, and it's by Colby Shea Perkins, another watercolor piece. So congratulations to both of those students. It's the first year, like I said, that any school has had two pieces selected from the same school. And the last piece that I have is the MILTI, Maine Laptop Technology Initiative. They have a screensaver art contest. Hundreds of pieces from across the state are entered into that, and the winning pieces are used as the screensavers in the coming years on the laptop image. And this is the piece that Catherine created for that. That will appear next year on those, on all the laptops in the state.
Oh, wow.
And she will be invited to a May conference for an award ceremony. Mm-hmm. Questions?
Yeah. Is there any way you can pass those around?
I can pass those around, yes.
We'll give them back to you after.
Surely.
Maybe.
Mm-hmm. There are names on the back.
And I'll just say that at any time that the middle school representatives would like to go home, that's fine. If they'd like to stay, that's also fine. But I just want to let them know they do not have to stay for this whole meeting. We wouldn't subject you to that. Okay, moving on. I'm going to ask the board if we can move up item 7A, consideration to approve concessions down at Hannaford Field, because our speaker is here and I'd rather not keep him waiting all night. So is that okay with the board?
Fine.
Okay, so Alan, do you want to?
Jeff,
sorry.
I believe Jeff is going to come up and also Alan to talk about the proposal. Just as a reminder, when this was brought to the board several months ago, it was approved with the understanding that they would just come back and talk about the plan that they've gone through to get ready to do this snack shack. I know they have spent an enormous amount of time waiting for each step to happen. So this is really an informational piece, just returning information to you. Jeff.
Sure. Before I begin, just would like to say I've learned a great deal personally from this experience, this civic, the protocols and the building codes. It was very enlightening, and thanks to the help with Alan Tebow, who really spearheaded and really took the bull by the horns here and got this going. Just did a terrific job, and I'd just like to thank the school board and the town council and the planning board for the time that they put into this as well. So basically, last year around this time, we put together a proposal to build or put a snack bar or a concession stand on the Hannaford Field complex, and use boosters would be able to use this facility to sell some food and do some fundraising, and it would be a structure that would be completely funded by the booster programs, so the school would not have any responsibility in the development and maintenance of the building as well. So I would like to introduce Alan Tebow. He can kind of fill us in on the process and where we are now. I think one of the expectations from the school board back in, I think it was about June, was to also put together some general procedures. So Alan will discuss that as well. Thank you.
Thank you, Jeff. As you know, when we presented the original plans to the school board, there was some questions about the maintenance. We've been working with the different booster organizations, and we've come up with a set of draft procedures on how the shed would be operated. Included in that is the guidance of the athletic department to make sure that if the policies and procedures aren't enforced, there is a person that Jeff can go to and say, your organization needs to step up and and clean up the shed or police the grounds afterwards so that there's some enforcement policies in place. In addition to that, there's some statement in the policy and procedures that the annual upkeep of the concession shed is the responsibility of the booster organizations. This includes painting and general maintenance and repair on an annual basis. It's encouraged that the booster seek volunteers to provide the maintenance. In the event that that doesn't happen, it gives Jeff some authority to step up and say, okay, it's looking a little ratty. We need to see about getting it painted this year. And if that doesn't happen, it gives Jeff the authority to go seek an outside source to do it and seek reimbursement from the booster organizations to offset those costs that might be incurred. We don't anticipate that that's going to happen. There is a pretty solid booster base from all the different sports using the Hannaford Field. Hundreds of people who have volunteered time and effort to help us with this, and we don't think that there'll ever be a problem at the field. We've continued with this. We're going to continue drafting these. We've gone out and sought the input from all the different booster groups. These have been provided to Jeff, and we'll finalize those and make those part of the policies and procedures before each booster group is given access to the shed. We'll make sure that that representative is working with Jeff. He knows who the contact person is, and the policies and procedures have been distributed on a regular basis to those groups. If there's any questions, we'd be happy to answer those at this time. We have received planning board approval for this, so after we, hopefully if we get approval tonight, we'll be able to go pull a building permit and start construction, hopefully to have this online for the first games, the beginning of the season for the spring sports. Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody want to ask questions? We're in question mode, and then when we get into discussion, that will be after the motion is made. So do you have any questions for the speakers?
Yes, I do. But first I have a question for Alan.
Yes.
You said that this was approved by the board several months ago. Was it before I was on the board?
Yes, it was. It was when Karen was still here. As a matter of fact, Karen was the one who approved it so it could go to the town council. But then they were to come back just to talk about what the plans had been, particularly to avoid any cost to the school board and to the school system.
Okay. Then I guess the fact I had 15 questions doesn't mean I have adult onset Alzheimer. It's just that I wasn't here. But I actually have a lot of questions, and I think I would take up probably too much time tonight. I have questions about insurance. I have questions about the standard by who may be able to utilize this. Any organization that supports CESH, Cape High School, indirectly or directly, that's an extremely broad standard. It's also the division of responsibility between booster groups versus the school. I guess I have a lot of questions on this. If this, I could probably put off, since we have a fairly full agenda today, all of my questions, if this was these procedures were considered a draft by which I'd be glad to talk to Jeff and give him all my questions. I have a lot of questions on this.
Well, we're voting on final approval tonight, so I would say that if you have questions, tonight's the night to ask them.
All right. The money that's being earned at this shed, how's it divided up? Does the school get any of the money, or does it just goes right back into the particular booster organization?
Yeah. So for each particular game, the boost for whatever team may be playing on that field that night, that booster group would be running the concession stand.
So
that money would go to back to that booster program.
And if that booster group was running the shed that time, they would be selling. Do they sell merchandise as well as food, or is it just food?
It would be probably a combination of both.
And the merchandise they would sell would be of that particular, whether it's football or soccer or whatever?
Yeah, generally, and what we've tried to do is be a little bit more generic as well with the products that are being sold. So given the fact that many of our families, our students and their families are participating in more than one sport, instead of selling three seat cushions with all different sports on it, more of a Cape Elizabeth Athletics or a CE logo on it or something like that, or an umbrella, whatever it may be.
Have you thought about the insurance problems with the fact that these are non-school employees running a building on school property, and what happens if some accident occurs?
I would defer those questions to Pauline and Alan.
I would have to go back and give you the specifics, but before, when we had a food check here, which was what, about
4 years ago that one burned. The insurance was carried through the school system at that point in time. And I'm looking at Pauline because I was pretty sure that's what it was. And then when the place burned, the money that was collected at that point came back to the school system and then moved on from there. So,
is it both insurance for fire as well as negligence insurance?
Yes,
liability? The shack that you're building, excuse me, you called it a shack, so I guess I will.
Shed, sorry.
Is it capable of being, it's hard for me, having seen this plot plan for the, relatively the first time, is it capable of being expanded if we decide at some point to expand that, to create more offerings and maybe earn more money at that spot?
Certainly. And one of the reasons why we went in this direction right now, given the economy, was the flexibility of potentially moving this structure and using it as a storage facility. Because at this point, we are gravely in need of storage. So if there was a, if the economy was to turn the corner and things were looking good and we were able to put something a little bit more permanent with some adequate water and electricity, there's certainly ample room in that area. And matter of fact, that the fence that's up there now could actually probably be moved a little bit to increase that area as well.
I'm trying to read my own handwriting, if you wait a second. Is there, in terms of having outside tournaments, by outside tournaments, I mean tournaments with, involving a lot of other people or people maybe using our field to conduct a soccer tournament, is there, there's nothing in the policy that deals with that if that shed was to be operated in that respect? Is that something you'll develop if that occurs, or has that occurred in the past?
Certainly. And there was some discussion on that even with some of the Saturday morning programs and how we could spread that out a little bit and give everyone an opportunity to possibly do some fundraising on Saturday morning events to any kind of a tournament event. But right now the thought was if it was, if there was a field hockey tournament of some sort, that the field hockey boosters would first have that option, and then if they wanted to, they could pass that down to if there was a youth organization or under the auspice of that high school field hockey booster group.
Is this going to be adopted as a policy and procedure of the school department, or no?
No.
My last question is, I would make a suggested change that you say that the shed may be utilized by any organization that supports Cape Elizabeth High School directly or indirectly. I would suggest, it's a question, but we'll talk about in the vote, that you change that to be used by any organization that's approved by you, as opposed to anybody that supports Cape Elizabeth High School. Someone from Presque Isle can say they support Cape Elizabeth High School, but it really should, you should be the one, or somebody within our system should be approved who gets to use it, rather than an indirect standard like that.
Okay.
Do you see a problem with that?
No, I think that's certainly reasonable. And as Alan and I had talked, we tried to put these together, thinking as outside the box as possible. So we've sent it out to a number of booster groups for their for their thoughts, and definitely would support any kind of additional.
It's just that something on school property and something that's under the auspices of our school athletic program, I would prefer to have that the use of this be under your control, so that I just think that's appropriate for school property.
Thank you, David. Does anybody else have any questions?
Okay.
Jeff, I apologize. I should know this answer. As representing the wellness committee, how does it work for providing foods that falls under the wellness policy guide, healthy foods, non-sugar, as our...
I think one of, and this is feedback that I hear from a lot of the opposing teams that come into Cape Elizabeth, is especially during the winter when we have a consistent concession stand set up, and the food offerings are pretty dynamic, with everything from chowder to chili. I think they're all kind of any kind of a pasta type thing. So the boosters do a really good job, and for the meal that you get, definitely worth every penny. I think they do an amazing job of kind of spreading out the responsibilities of who's making what, and really, really good food choices. And it's pretty diverse as well. It's not just your traditional hot dog and a soda. I think they're pretty balanced.
I guess it might be for a policy question in our policy meeting, but Reese's, Coca-Cola, candy, that, I believe I should check the policy on that
Kate, that's almost a separate issue, which, and given our really heavy agenda tonight, I would encourage you under the Wellness Committee discussions to continue that. I know that we've had it in the past as to how to include booster groups and travel team type groups to be included in our approach to wellness. But you have to recognize that if they're booster groups and if they're travel teams, we have much more limited impact on those decisions. But I encourage you to have that conversation in the Wellness Committee.
Okay. And it could be certainly a nice diversion from our when we're having our booster representative meetings have been pretty intense lately with the school budget. So it might be a nice conversation to have to kind of get away from that topic a little bit and do something a little more productive.
Thank you.
Okay, any more questions about the shed? Okay, do I have a motion?
I move that we approve the concession stand at Hannaford Field with the change that David suggested, that the control of that concession stand be under the auspices of the athletic director.
Is there a second? Okay, discussion?
The only discussion I have is I appreciate the suggested amendment, and I think Jeff has the spirit of it from that, is ultimately I want him to be able to prove what happens there, and I think that's encompassed. Just to make the record clear, I think that's encompassed in what Kathy Ray said.
And if you want to change the wording, I'm just trying to include what you suggested, because I think that was a good suggestion.
I don't think I need to, but I will, if you let me to, that the amendment be that the second sentence be stricken, and that in its place of the general procedures, in its place, that the HFCS will be utilized only upon approval by the athletic director and only in a manner approved by the athletic director.
Accepted.
Okay. Any other discussion? Okay. All those in favor? 6-0. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, now we're getting back on track to communications, and we have a new A, which is the communications plan. Mary?
Mm-hmm. Thanks, Rebecca. I wanted to talk briefly about a new position that we have. It's a volunteer position as part of our efforts to improve communications between the school and the community. We, back in February, posted a job description for a volunteer communications coordinator to help improve external communications and communications from school to school. We received a few applications and two real standouts, and we're happy to announce that we have hired on a volunteer basis Sharon Roberts. She has graciously volunteered her time to help us with particularly the external media and community requests. Sharon, for those of you who don't know her, has extensive professional communications experience with 30 years at Anthem. She was director of stakeholder relations and then more recently chief of staff for the Maine market for Anthem. In addition, she's a 30-year resident and has put two kids through the school system and is married to former town councilor Jack Roberts, for those of you who remember him from a few years ago. So her initial job will be, at this point, helping us develop a strategy, which we have an initial strategy for tackling budget communications. And Sharon's going to come up and talk about that. And while she's going to the podium, I will also say that we have another volunteer, Katie Gillespie, who is a lifelong CAPE resident and a CAPE High School graduate, and now is raising her children and putting them through the system, who will help with the school-to-school communications. So Sharon, if you wouldn't mind giving us a brief overview of the communications plan for the budget. Sharon's come up with some really wonderful ideas for helping the community understand the budget process and connecting the community with the school, or the community at large with the school community during this time. So,
thank you. It's a pleasure to be here. It's been fun so far. It's been about 10 days, and I've been enjoying it. So, we have. I'm working with Mary and the Communications Committee. We have come up with what we think is a broad-based approach to trying to supplement the normal communication that you would expect through your public hearings and your workshop process. We're hoping that we will use the website extensively by posting a lot of information. We've worked hard there today at the meeting tonight in the back of the room. We have a one-page back and front page document that helps to hopefully explain some of the key pieces about the budget deliberations and what you'll be exploring and talking about over the next 6 weeks. Additionally, we have a meeting scheduled, a public meeting scheduled for the superintendent and yourselves to meet with the public, be able to talk to them in a less formal setting than a public hearing, answer questions, and be able to have some community conversation back and forth about the budget itself. We'll also be crafting on the web and the opportunity for folks to sign up and be included on an interested parties list. And from that, what we hope to be doing is that periodically we will update that as we go through the process over the next 6 weeks with where we are, what kinds of things are coming up, reminders about public hearings and other sessions that will be happening as we go. And then what we'll do is hopefully learn from those pieces and supplement additionally as we go forward. And then as the process moves beyond your adoption and onto the process with the town council and then the election process or the referendum process, whatever the appropriate terminology is, we'll also then craft some more tactics to ensure that we're getting the information out and that people have a clear view of what's going on, what the decisions are, what the rationale behind them is. So we're hoping to help the broader understanding, first of all, amongst the public in the town, in the community, so that they understand more about the budget process and the budget itself, but secondarily, to find some more ways for public involvement and community input into the process so that there is just a broader perspective and folks feel like they have that opportunity. So, in a nutshell.
Wonderful. Thank you. Any questions?
I guess I would just add that the public it's not a public hearing, the public meeting has been scheduled for the 30th of March at 7 p.m. at the high school.
Correct.
Yes. And I believe, if I'm not mistaken, that there's also been a meeting scheduled for teachers this Thursday, March 11th, at 3:30 at the Pond Cove cafeteria, I think. There's been a lot of things going on in my office today, but that's what I think I remember being told.
Yeah. I think that's correct. There'll be a meeting of the superintendent will have to be able to meet with and talk to them, explain to teachers and answer questions and get their input as well.
David?
I have one question for Mary. Couple questions. One, I saw a very excellent press release that came to my email. Has that press release been disseminated to the major news organizations in the area and put in the MSPA, the three parents organizations for sending to all the parents?
It has gone to the external press. Whether it has gone to, I think, did you send it to your administrators?
I th- I have to look at them because I have been so crazy the last few days. Did you get it? No, I don't think it has. Andrea hasn't sent it.
Okay, well, we'll do that tomorrow, and that's the press release that announces the hiring of Sharon and...
It also has a nice outline of what role they play. I just think it should be in the Parents Association newsletters.
Good point.
As wide a dissemination as you can, because this is a fairly major shift.
Right.
My other question would be, the volunteers going to be operating under the auspices of the Communications Committee? In other words, are you going to be working with them on what the communications are, or is Alan, or is Rebecca?
So far, it's been a three-pronged. I mean, we've all worked together.
So I managed to cover everybody.
I know. We've all worked together as a team with Sharon, and I think it's worked well that way. We've put together a one-page, as Sharon was saying, that one-page front and back budget at a glance document with everyone's input.
We did not include Kathy in some of the initial parts, and that's my apology. We've been very new at this and scrambling at the last minute, and it will be the four of us working together with the volunteers.
The reason why I express that is, as a question, also as a concern, it's very hard to get the message right at any one point in time, especially since it's our message as a board. I feel more assured that we've got four people looking at it, because there's a certain tone, a certain way that you would want to say this. And if possible, if any major releases are to go out, that send them to the committee as a whole. It would be appreciated, since if it's, I hate to have to disagree with something after it went out, but if it's not possible, I'm comfortable with the four people that are doing it.
Yeah, okay. And as far as your question about getting things out to the parent associations, part of what Katie will be doing is, once we get her position up and running, is dispersing information school to school like that. And last week, another committee member gathered all of the email addresses for the boosters and all of the internal school groups, as well as CEF, so we can start dispersing information.
Thank you.
Internally. So thank you.
Thank you very much, Sharon.
Thank you, Sharon.
Okay, moving on to 6B, resignations.
Yes.
And retirements.
You have in your packet one letter of resignation and two retirements. I bring these to you so you are well aware of what is going on. The first is a resignation, and that is from Evan Solander, who is currently a teacher at Keith Elizabeth Middle School. In it, he talks about his mixed emotions, and I'm writing to you to officially tender my resignation effective at the end of this school year. He has been in Cape Elizabeth for 9 years and has found his work at Cape Elizabeth immensely rewarding and appreciates all that has been done for him, and that he will be taking up a new position at Chapel Hill, North Carolina. For retirements, I have two. Moving a little away from Rebecca, because I know she probably hit me with one of these. The first one is a very interesting letter. It's with mixed emotion that I am planning to resign my position as band director at Cape Elizabeth Middle School at the end of the school year 2009-10. I am planning to retire from teaching after 34 years in order to pursue my music composing and arranging. To say it's been a great ride would truly be an understatement. The thousands of students and parents that I have had the opportunity to meet over these years have enriched my life beyond belief. To be able to finish my career here in Cape Elizabeth has been an honor. The community's support of education in general and music specifically is something to be very proud of. Although this is a huge step for my wife and me, and somewhat frightening, I feel it is the right time for me to come to this decision. Writing music has been a passion of mine for most of my life, and some opportunities have presented themselves recently that encouraged me to come to this decision. Leaving Cape Elizabeth will be very difficult, as they have been wonderful to my family and me for the past 12 years. I leave knowing the community will continue to support the music program, and they have, as they have in the past, making it one of the outstanding instrument programs in Maine and beyond. And that's signed by Terry White, who I know will be sorely missed. The second letter is from Susan Safer,
who is at Pond Cove, and she writes, "I am writing to let you know of my intent to retire at the end of the school year. This has not been an easy decision for me, as I love what I do, and I've enjoyed working in Cape Elizabeth school system. I hope that I have made some contributions to the students, families, and the school department. It will likely be a difficult transition for me, but I feel that it's time to pursue other things. I am grateful for the opportunity for professional growth that this job has offered me during my many years of employment, and I am particularly appreciative that I have had the good fortune to work with such a competent group of colleagues. In recent years, I know that I have been able to have a positive impact on my many students because of the flexible, insightful, and creative leadership provided by Dominic DePazzi. His willingness to create change has enabled me to try new approaches and ideas to be a more effective clinician." And that is Susan Safer, who will also be sorely missed. So at this point in time, with these, you have 8 retirements from the school system to be activated at the end of the year.
I have a question.
Yes.
Rebecca?
Mm-hmm.
Is it standard procedure to do exit interviews of people who move on to other positions?
I've often done that, and I probably will this year once I can get past this time of year.
What time of year is that?
Yeah.
The other thing is, I just want to make a comment about Evan Solander. He was the math teacher for my son. And I have to tell you, he was a truly inspiring teacher. He did a wonderful job with my son, who was convinced he wasn't very smart at math. He ended up getting, I think, about a 99 from Evan Solander. He was a superb teacher. He was very well-liked. He was always accessible. He was a superb math teacher. And I personally, and I'm sure the middle school will sorely miss him. I just wanted to say that.
Thank you. I think we can say that about all of the retirees that we...
He was the only one I knew.
Okay. Okay, moving on to NEASC accreditation, the 5-year report. Jeff.
Could I ask, because we have somebody waiting in the audience, Penny Jordan, would it be possible to switch the health report up, unless Penny is willing to list? You're, it's fine? Okay. I have to stay here anyways. Okay. I think you need help.
I don't think actually this is going to be long, so.
I just really asked Alan to put this on the agenda because I think it's been a while since I stood before the board to talk about accreditation, and there is a milestone that's coming up, which is our 5-year progress report is due. For those of you who don't know, every region of the country has a regional accreditation agency. Ours is NEASC, which is short for the New England Association of Schools and Colleges. As its name applies, it's an accreditation agency for high schools and colleges across the New England region. There's one division that specializes, that focuses its work with public high schools. So we have a 5-year progress report, which is due on April 1st. And what NEASC expects us to do is, as a result of their visit back in 2000 and something or other, four, I think, they issued a report which includes some commendations and recommendations and things like that, and we have to periodically report back in terms of the progress we've made, where we have completely accomplished tasks that they have identified for us, where we are making progress, and if there are some which we have decided we don't agree with. So I will be working on that report. Just so the board is aware, the whole accreditation process over the course of about 10 years costs about, is an investment of the school district's money, the town's money, of about $40,000 to $50,000. It's a lot of money. There are some schools, including Portland, which have recently made the decision to no longer go through the accreditation process because there are, frankly, some frustrations that come along with it. And I think everybody who goes through it finds both the positive things and the frustrations. I will also say that the fact that the report is due has prompted a group of us to begin to look at, as we are supposed to do from time to time, the school mission statement, to revisit it. It's been several years. I think it was passed by the board in 2003. I think at least a couple of you were here at that time. So we are,
there's a small group of us that just met last week to begin to informally look at it. If there are any board members who are interested in being a part of that process, there's some particular aspects of it that have been proven to be problematic in terms of implementation in a way that is educationally points us in a direction that we think is worthwhile. So we're going to be taking a look at that. But NEASC very much says, here's the school mission that you've identified. How can we be confident that you're meeting those things? But once you put something in your mission statement, there's a whole slew of NEASC recommendations that come along with it, that and some of which have tremendous educational benefit attendant to the work that comes with that, and some of them, frankly, have less benefit in terms of what you actually have to do. I will say that there will be some areas where we have accomplished things. There will be some areas where we say that we don't think they're worthwhile, and there's been some areas where we are making progress, but we're not there. I will say also that I always have to make the, as I approach each year, begin to think about, okay, where do I really want to invest my time? And we as a school district, I think over the past few years, have spent an awful lot of time focusing on K through 12 integration, curriculum work, and those sorts of things. There is nothing in the NEASC report that deals has anything to do with curriculum integration K through 12, because they only look at the high school. If we weren't doing that work, honestly, we would be further along on some of the work that was specific to the high school, but I really think that we need to spend that time. And I think it's well invested. So when the progress report is done, I will certainly give a copy to the board. It becomes a public document at that point. The NEASC commission will then, in the spring, I'm not sure exactly which meeting it is. It's either the May meeting or the June meeting. They'll be looking at our report along with reports from hundreds of other schools. And at some point, we'll get a report from them about whether we're making sufficient progress towards what they've identified for us.
Jeff, is that the spring of this year or next year?
They turn them around pretty quickly. They literally have a commission that looks at dozens, and I mean, they have a staff that sort of looks at the reports in detail. I hope I haven't spoken to you. It may be that it's the fall that the letters actually come out. It may be that what happens is the commission meets, they find some tentative things, and then they make a final decision in the fall. But it's pretty quick.
Okay, so what is the deadline for the completion of your progress report?
April 1st.
April 1st, I missed that. Thank you.
Yes.
Question? Yeah. Back in 2004, I think I was on that group, but
yes,
the group of NEASC folks came to the school.
Correct.
And interviewed a bunch of us and did a whole bunch of things. Do we expect that same thing this year? Is it?
No, not this year. That would be 5 years from now.
Okay.
Those visits are every 10 years, and then schools have to provide 2-year progress reports and 5-year progress reports, and I think those are the major ones, and then any additional reports that have to be done. I will say there are some very positive things that come out of NEASC. One of the things that came out for us is they told us, actually we told them in our self-report, then they echoed back to us that we were a little bit, our written curriculum did not match the unwritten curriculum that we had, and then we had to write some stuff down. So they kicked us in the pants for that, legitimately so, and we got our written curriculum done very, very quickly. So it's been actually the basis for a lot of things that have happened over the past few years, and have put us in a place in doing that K through 12 work that has helped a lot of that work, and I think helped to shape some of that work.
John?
Jeff, could you briefly opine on the decision that Portland made not to seek this accreditation?
Yep. I don't know a tremendous amount about it, but
well, I guess
I know
what I'm interested in is what you see as the advantages and disadvantages of pursuing that path.
Let me say first, the advantage of accreditation, which I'm a big fan of, is that there's an external check on how a school is doing. The once every 10-year visit provides a good snapshot of where the school is at one point in time. But because there's not another visit for another 10 years, what Portland is opting to do, I understand it, is to align themselves with an organization which does not advertise itself as and is not intended to be an alternative to accreditation, but it's an organization in Maine which actually does national consulting. It's called the Great Schools Partnership. Some of you may have heard of it. Actually, I think one of the town councilors is on the board of directors of the Great Schools Partnership. I think Frank Governale is on that board. I have had some preliminary conversations with them just to see how that might work. The advantage of something like that is it's a bang for the buck question, because for the same money, because $50,000 is a lot of money, you can work with a group of people more closely who are real experts in the field, and you can develop a relationship over time that gives you some more regular feedback. Sometimes the NEASC thing the NEASC accreditation process has a feeling of a paper chase. And in terms of really impacting student learning in the most meaningful ways, I'm not sure it's always the most beneficial. There's some really, really, really good things that come out of it. But I have been talking to some folks from that organization. But again, I have to say very explicitly that they are not an alternative to accreditation. If we decided what Portland is essentially doing is abandoning accreditation. That can make some schools nervous because they fear that somehow students would be harmed in the college admissions process. From what I understand, that may not be the case if, in fact, you can demonstrate that there are other ways that you're ensuring that there's an external check on the quality of the school. So we're looking at it, and I've had some initial conversations with Alan about that, and I'm trying to set up a meeting with some folks from the Great Schools Partnership just to have that conversation, because I think it is a lot of money. Because the way NEASC works is that every 10-year visit, it's not expert staff members who come up, is they recruit teachers and guidance counselors and things from schools across New England to come up and visit. And it's a one-time thing for 2.5 days. I've served on a number of those committees, and I will say that I get a tremendous amount out of going to other schools and visiting. Whether I give to them the same value that I get from it, just from the opportunity to be able to explore another school in depth, is always a question I walk away with wondering about.
Thank you.
Yep.
Thanks, Jeff.
Thank you.
Okay, so we have next guidance, curriculum, priority learning goals.
That's correct. I'd just like to comment on it for a few minutes. As Jeff talked about, we have been doing an enormous amount of work over the last 2 years as far as curriculum is concerned. We have a curriculum instruction and assessment committee, which I have to admit has not met for a few months because of the schedule that we've all been under because of other demands, but the individual committees have been meeting on a regular basis. I chair the guidance curriculum. It has been a fascinating process because we really did not have a comprehensive guidance plan, and so we have been working at it diligently over the last few months. As a matter of fact, we have another meeting tomorrow from 1 until 3 at least to try to finalize our report to bring to you in March. I would have to say to you that one of the members of that committee has certainly offered some help to me today because of everything else that's been going on. And so Kim Sturgeon is here. As I said to some of you, I think it's because we both come from Lincoln, Maine, that we have a special interest in how this goes. But Kim is going to go over our plan briefly. I'm also going to hand you new copies for this reason. Kim has worked hard in the last few days to update this based on Pond Cove, the high school, and the middle school. So I'm going to be passing you new copies that will replace the ones that are in your booklet. These are more updated and have a better sequence of information there. And Kim, thank you very, very much for doing this. I appreciate it.
And I actually have something to add to it because what you are being handed out by Alan right now is a copy of what would be our priority and secondary learning goals. And if any of you have worked with guidance counselors before, you may recognize that the curriculum piece of what we do is only one component. And, you know, depending upon which level, whether it's the elementary, middle, or high school, the curriculum piece is a certain percentage. And what I've done is I have a graph there that shows what percentage would be the curriculum, the guidance curriculum piece. And there's some recommended pieces that are in that table that's down at the bottom that comes out of ASCA, which is our American School Counselors Association, and say what percentage of our time. And definitely in 2 weeks from now, when we do our full presentation, K-12, we'll get into specifically what the Pond Cove guidance counselors are doing, what we're doing at the middle school, and what the high school does in regards to those delivery system components. But the other pieces do include the individual student planning that we do, responsive services, as well as system supports. So the piece that Alan did hand out, there's kind of two pieces to the document. One, and I don't know what order to put this document is.
Here's an extra one.
The first graph, I just need to see which order. There were two pieces to it. The first chart has a lot of check marks there, and what it is, it's the ASCA models, the competencies. If you look in the left-hand column, those would be the priority learning goals, and they're broken into the three domains, which would be under academic, career, and then personal, social. And under each of those are standards, and they're broken into competencies in a very similar fashion to what our main state, the parameters for essential learning are. And our parameters for essential learning under the main guidelines has the career guidance piece, and those are pretty well aligned with the ASCA model, the career piece that falls under there. So those priorities, what we've done and what we're continuing to work on is that check mark system. We're in the process of continuing to retune and refine our curriculum that we do present, and those check marks will indicate which of the competencies we're hitting, because it's really hard when you're only spending about 30% of your time in the classroom because of the other areas that are very important as well. So we're working at those. The second piece, again, it's the same information, it's just in a very, it's in a different format, because the second chart that you'll find after the checkmark system are those same competencies, and just broken into showing you that the priority learning goals are the ones that are your standards, you know, kind of the bigger picture, and then the secondary learning goals would be the competencies themselves. In each grade level hits the different competencies that developmentally the children are ready for. How much sense in trying to do a 5-minute spin on what a, you know, hour and a half, a 2-hour presentation 2 weeks from now will be.
Well, and we'll cover a lot of this.
It will be covered in much more depth then, but I think this is supposed to be just kind of a quick little snapshot and then the bigger picture.
To clarify for members in the audience and public at home, we will be having a workshop at the end of this month where we'll be discussing these learning goals and the report that the guidance committee puts together for the teaching and learning committee / workshop. So tonight is just a chance to maybe ask some brief questions, but I would suggest that we all take the time to really dive into this and then provide with Mary as soon as you can any questions that you might like answered at the workshop, so that the guidance committee has a chance to prepare it ahead of time with the understanding that you may have additional questions at the workshop that you can ask them.
Just a quick question. Who do we provide those questions to? I thought it was
Mary.
Okay, thank you. Just making sure.
Okay.
Do you believe you have the right amount of staff to do the work? As I'm looking at the check marks, I just wanted to see how well staffed we are.
Based on the ASCA model and where we are at the middle school, we do fit within the confines of, you know, we're at, what, 550 students, so say about 275, I'm doing my math right, students per guidance counselor. Sometimes I can say yes, sometimes I can say no. It really does depend on the nature of the job that we're doing. If we're in the midst of kneecap testing and or a big crisis is happening, it really does depend. Other times it ebbs and flows. But I do think that we have, especially, you know, in our department in the middle school and working with Gretchen McCoy, I don't know, we have a tremendous team and really do, I think, have a good number that matches the needs of our students. So,
thank you.
And the other guidance counselors may answer differently at the other buildings, so I'm not going to answer for them. But.
Thank you. Thank you, Gretchen.
Thank you.
Okay. Great. Thank you. Great. So, Penny. Cape Elizabeth Employee Health Insurance Committee final report. And David, I'm sorry. I'm not sure. I wasn't sure if you were going to get up this
morning. Yeah. Wow.
It'll avoid a lot of questions.
Oh, yeah.
Can I get your bag cleaned out here?
Sure, why not? I'll go first.
You always want to go first. I just think you should talk to the landlord because it's freezing.
It's cold.
Jeez.
It is cold. And I think it's hot, so I don't know what it went.
We're saving oil.
Now with my hat on as the chairperson of the combined health insurance review committee commissioned by the town and the school board, we have presented to all of you a report that is extremely detailed, has a lot of attachments. We will, Penny and I will divide up, and we'll try to make it relatively short. Penny's going to explain to you the methodology we came up with to analyze the quality of our plans and the cost of our plans, as well as comparables we used and why we used them to see if we could do better in under a different methodology. And I will, you have the summary conclusions and recommendations in the executive report, and I drafted that, so I'm solely responsible for that. But I before we start, I do want to thank two unbelievable staff people, Pauline Portricia. I'm at least getting to the R after the T. Before it was before the D. I'm doing better, Pauline. And Matt Sturgis, they were unbelievable. Pauline gathered a huge amount of data from other towns, from the plans, summarized it, created grids for us. It was tremendous work. And Matt, the last 2 weeks, during vacation, and for about six straight days, sat in a room with either myself and Penny or myself alone, and probably did about six more drafts of this report. And it was an enormous help. Suggestions, and it wasn't just getting what we wanted, it was telling us where we were wrong, where we were right, making suggestions. They're absolutely unbelievable. And they did this in addition to all their other responsibilities. So as I said in my cover letter, we thank them for their efforts. And to quote Sally Field, we really, really mean it. So I'll turn it over to Penny to discuss the methodology.
Okay. Basically what I want to talk about is I'm going to try to just do a brief overview. I mean, there's a lot of data in here, and I can go into a lot of detail. But I think that I think you just recently received this document, so you have a lot of reading to do. And basically what we did is, as a team, and also on the committee were Al Barthelman, Mary Townsend, Kyle Parrish, Jim Walsh, and as you know, our illustrious chairperson, David Hillman. We basically set out and we did research around what existed today in the contracts that we had, in the personnel codes, what benefits were offered. We also had a meeting with MEA and MMA trusts in order to gain a firmer understanding of the benefit plans that were being offered and what type of flexibility we might have within those plans. After, you know, sweeping through that research, we really looked at the existing situation from a municipal as well as a school perspective, looking at the number
employees, the number of employees enrolled in the various plans, what were the plan selections, what type of cost sharing existed, and also what were the premiums for the existing plans. On the municipal side, for the town's portion of the premium, it is $425,945 on an annual basis. On the school side, for the annualized premium, it's in the $2.5 million range. We looked at that and we said, okay, we've got these classes of employees, we've got this premium. Okay, now let's go take a look at what other towns might have. Now, with the MMA, they offer 5 different plans to various towns across the state. Cape Elizabeth selects 2 of them. Some towns select the same ones that we select, some select from the others. If you select the same plans, you have the same premium. With the MEA, you select the same plans, you got the same premium. So the differentiator when we looked at other towns was the cost share, or if somebody offered in lieu of, if somebody chose not to take benefits. So there wasn't a lot of disparity from a monthly premium perspective. So then what we said is, okay, if we go outside the trust and we go direct to insurance companies, what might that look like? So basically what we did is we took and we played through a couple of scenarios. And we took the a plan such as the point of service plan for the schools and compared it to a point of service plan for we took it for the schools and we compared it to a private company. And basically what we did is we just wanted to look at what might the difference be. It ended up, from a school perspective, that there would be a variance, a difference, if you're figuring 88% cost share, of approximately $316,286.01. So on the school side, we said, okay, there's potential here for savings. Relative to the municipality, we did a similar thing. We took a plan that would be similar. We compared it to private companies, and we came out with a potential savings if we went direct of approximately $14,730. So what it said to us is there's opportunity. What? How big is that opportunity? The fact that we did not factor in increases in premium for 2010-2011 says that there could be a greater savings than what we anticipated. Our key is that we want to ensure that we offer comparable plans at a more competitive rate with a savings to the town as well as the employees. So we were constantly thinking of how do you save money for the municipality, whether it be the schools or the municipal side, as well as the employees. So now that we knew that there was an opportunity, we came to some conclusion.
Penny, before we move on, can you tell us how much was the savings for the employee?
For the what?
The employee side. So you calculated what it was for the district. I'm curious what it was.
I got it right here. For the employee side, for the schools, it would have been on an annualized basis approximately $43,000 or $224 per employee. On the municipal side, it would be about $3,600 and about $81 per employee.
It gets a little bit confusing. I want you to know the totals before I get into it. When Penny was talking about it, the actual total savings for both the school and the employee is about $360,000. She was quoting just the school's portion saving. And the total savings for both the municipality and the individual is about $18,000. This is understated, in our opinion, because there is an HMO option that's not offered, and that is significantly cheaper than a POS plan. And if you did that, that would be a significant increase in savings for both the town and the individuals. Roughly, it's about $1,000 a year cheaper, on a 90-10 split, that's about $100 more for, on a family basis, $100 more for the employee and about $900 more per employee that, for the time. So this is a very conservative estimate. We also, now, into our conclusions, and I have to say that we did meet at length with both the MEA and with the MMA, and they were subjected to what some board members called a rigorous cross-examination by some long-winded member of the board. And we got a lot of pushback, which I think is reflected in other towns' attempts in our attachments. I think personally our committee and Bangor and a few other places were responsible for the fact that the increase this year was only about 2% instead of what you heard potentially would be, because they knew that a lot of towns were thinking of going elsewhere. Now, into the conclusions and recommendations, they're really on pages 6 through 10. I'll just hit a few, then I'd like to open the questions for those that have read it. We got a lot of questions from the town council, but they had a whole week to read it. So I'm available, as you know, and Penny would be available to ask if you hadn't had a chance to look at it. We concluded that while the statewide plans of the MEA and MMA offered excellent benefits, they were priced high, on the upper end of reasonableness. And it was because it's a statewide plan, and there's a variety of reasons for that. But in northern Maine, the prices are higher. There's less competition, less providers, the usual customary rates are much higher, and they don't discount. And that's also why, because it's a statewide plan, they offer the same premium. So even though if you broke off Southern Maine and did it, you could get a much cheaper premium, they don't have that philosophy. They will only offer a statewide plan. And they, after significant questioning, their attorney was present, finally cut it short by admitting that they would never offer anything other than a statewide plan. They would never be able to offer an HMO because they can't get a network in Northern Maine because none of them will join, because they'll have to. And if we went just with the Southern Maine, I think he was estimating about a 20% savings. And that's roughly what we were calculating, a 15 to 20% savings. We tried to, the methodology we looked at on point two, we looked at, we figured out the reasons why it was cheaper in Southern Maine. There's more competition because there's more health insurers in Southern Maine with adequate networks so they can compete in the bid process, whereas in Northern Maine they can't. We made a series of other recommendations, but we believe that you can obtain virtually identical benefits at a lower cost to the employee and the town, which would enable the town to retain and attract quality employees, which was part of our charge, at the same time saving money. We determined that recommendation with self-insurance was not the way to go, although that seems to be the thing in vogue by some towns for a couple of reasons. The main one reason being that for a town like the Sound of Cape Elizabeth, self-insure would be a very large risk, and you can only do it with a reinsurance, which is would be phenomenally expensive, that we estimate would eat up any savings. Plus, you'd have to hire a benefits coordinator and a claims manager, all of which are at significant cost. We can't rule it out. There's a state law against it, by the way, but we can't rule it out. But we thought the more direct, quick, simple method was go direct to the insurance company, make them competitively bid. We hire a broker. He helps us design the plan, so we offer what we want, and then they bid against each other. We mentioned the recommendation. It would be very helpful if we got claims usage data or utilization information. We don't have it here in Cape Elizabeth, and when we ask for it, they refuse to give it to us. That's what's happened in Bangor. I explain in here that they say certain times they can't do it, which, as you'll see, our response is that that's simply impossible. They can do it. And they won't do it, which is true, they won't, but we also make recommendations in here about how legally, through lobbying, through passing the law in the state legislatures, through dealing with your insurance, and even the union may be asking for the information that can be given out. And we were also told that there's a state law which may require it, but we did the statute beaver on our team got tired of looking up statutes, so we thought the next committee might take a look at that. In terms of our recommendations, one thing to mention, our collective bargaining agreement with our schools requires us to use the MEA trust, and it'll last another year. We've discovered a statute we believe makes that provision null and void. It requires, it's cited in the point 12 of our recommendations, it requires school boards that they, we believe, but again, we're not offering a legal opinion, we believe it requires school boards that they're going to offer insurance that they must competitively bid it out, which is not what we did. And therefore, since we didn't follow the law, I think that provision of the, we think the provision of the collective bargaining agreement may be invalid, which if we work quickly, it's possible that maybe we could get something in for next year, but certainly the year after. The wonderful thing about that statute is if it's read the way we think it might be read, it will require school districts to competitively bid the health plans, which virtually ends the, I'll think of a, the fact that the MEA virtually gives insurance to virtually all school districts in the state of Maine. Certainly in southern Maine. We made some recommendations. As I said, the major ones, we think it would be good for the school board and for the town to appoint another joint committee, smaller, hire a broker to help design plans, hire a broker to also advise us whether or not self-insurance is the way to go, this broker would also do a variety of other things in terms of setting up the competitive bidding process. Again, this is all required by that statute, and requiring insurers to bid against each other. That broker would be free. They are paid by the insurance companies. We also recommend that you hire an attorney to be able to get the utilization data. We could still get a plan based on what's called community rating. They simply take your zip code, your age, the age of employees, excuse me, and the assets whether you're a smoker or not, and they can community rate you. That would be much higher than if you had claims data. If we had to, we could have a plan to community rate for 2 or 3 years, keep our own data, and then go on get a readjusted premium thereafter. But it would be much cheaper and easier if we could get the claims data. We also made some suggestions about adding additional benefits or additional plans like an HMO, which we are convinced in Southern Maine offers virtually the same network and the same benefits as the POS plan. POS being point of service. You can stay within your network of providers, but you pick somebody out, but then you pay 30% of the charge. But in the HMO, you pay, stay within network, you don't pay any more than your normal copay. We think an HMO should be offered, also a high deductible plan, health savings accounts, which I'm sure you're relatively familiar with, is another way to get benefits. We also think it would be worthwhile collaborating with other towns, the Cynthia and Trust laws allow it to maybe increase your leverage and increase the opportunities to get a good benefit. There's a couple more points, but the last one is we think that the school side should offer larger incentives for people to go on to their spouse's plan or get their plans elsewhere than here. And when Penny mentioned in lieu of, what we mean is cash in lieu of. It's Latin for instead of. A Latin teacher will tell me I didn't translate properly. But you offer them cash, say $3,000, instead of us paying 90% of a $10,000 plan, they go on another plan. So we actually save a great deal of money. And those sorts of things are being done on the municipal side, are being done by other schools, and we think it should be done by Cape Elizabeth as well. And that's speaking quite quickly, I'm finished, and we're glad to answer the questions.
Thank you very much. Questions? John, sorry.
Sorry.
You're more forceful with that finger.
Well, I was waiting to see. this seems like a simple question, but in terms of your methodology, why was it that you couldn't simply ask providers for pricing?
Well, I'm not sure.
In other words, you compared with a private company.
We got from a price. First of all, an insurance company's not going to give you a price without knowing what the heck the product is. They can't price it until they know the
product. We know what our employees, the demographics of our employees, right?
Right. but they're not about to quote a price unless you give them claims data. What we did is the exact same
thing. I understand you can't get that more specific pricing based on claims history.
What we decided to do, because we talked about that, because in many types of insurance, if you just give basic census, you can usually get some sort of what would the rate be. But we felt at that point it would not have been, I guess, in, how did Kyle put it? It's like if you go out and do that and you're really not going to follow through with it, is that really a fair thing to be doing with the insurance companies at that point in time? When we could really get comparables from just some basic plans that were out there. And there was a wonderful man that Mr. Kennedy was.
Robert Kennedy of Arcadia Benefits.
Robert Kennedy provided us with just some basic plan and rate information that we could do comparables to. So we had like four different companies that we compared to.
Let me further define that. We actually had four comparable ones. We had almost identical POS plans. And we found one that even had the unique feature of our school system, which they allow retirees to be part of the plan if they pay the full benefit. That substantially modifies your premium. And that is the company A we use in here as a comparable. And that's where we got actual premiums that were quoted on a competitive bid basis, which is what we'd have to follow, and actually done in a competitive bid atmosphere with an entity that was substantially identical to us in all respects. And that's why we got the most accurate premiums to compare against. Rather than simply asking an insurance company to blindly quote a premium, they would have had no reliance on the reliability of that premium. Quote.
Okay. I have another different question, which is, and I'm sorry, but I only read the executive summary, and well, maybe
the,
in the...
The town council virtually all said the same thing, so don't worry.
I will read the rest, particularly because it actually made me laugh at one point. And
now
I'm so surprised to laugh out loud in reading a health insurance report.
That
probably
must
read
be something
the rest.
I wrote.
Can you just touch on what other districts, if any, in the state have moved away from MEA's program, or would we be pioneering this?
Well, at this stage, I'd have to say we would be a pioneer. I'm going to try and make this less offensive than what happened at our meeting. We were told that two did it, but they came crawling back. Now, I am sure that if I was allowed to, if that person was allowed to cross-examine further, you would have found that there were two northern towns who couldn't really subsist by themselves. Southern towns can. We would be pioneers because they have virtually for quite some time had every school district. And why this statute has gone ignored all this time, I don't know. I don't think people knew it existed. It's not putting the insurance laws, it's putting under the powers of the school board. Very unusual place to have requirement for how you do insurance. So they basically have had a virtual lock on it, and there's also a relationship between the MEA's trust and the MEA, and so they felt comfortable with it. I don't have a historical data to compare the premiums. If I did, using the company A, I would have bet in every year for the last 4 years it was substantial savings if we'd gone the competitive bid route. But I think it's historical ways people do things, and they didn't. Let me give you the best example. Every law firm in this state got their insurance from the Maine State Bar Association Trust. A number of years ago, a law firm, my law firm, and a few other law firms, decided these rates were really high. We went the competitive bid route. We did so well that all major law firms did, and that trust doesn't, it still exists, but it's virtually no people. Because once you go out and do one-on-one bidding, especially in Southern Maine, you can beat any statewide rate. But nobody thought of it until all of a sudden costs got tight, and people looked at different things and decided there were alternatives, and the competitive bid process has worked extremely well for the last 4 years based on my own personal experience.
And is it the opinion of the committee that we can just go out and get a competitive bid and then accept it and move forward, or do we need to overcome some legal obstacles?
Well, there's two. I think to get the best competitive bid, you need claims data. And as of right now, it won't be given up voluntarily. Now, you might be able to get it if you take a look at the law and get it quickly. But, you know, they're up against a statute which requires competitive bidding. So it's very interesting how that dynamic is going to play out. The other thing you have to remember is what health plan you offer is still a function of what you negotiate in the collective bargaining agreement with the local union. The local union may say, fine, you can save a lot of money, but we feel more comfortable with our union plan. I personally would be a bit surprised, given the amount of savings at stake for the town, especially, and for the employee, and creative ways could come up by this new committee about maybe sharing some of that savings a little bit more with the employee, that they might be enticed to do it. They would get, my guess, is they would get a lot of pressure from the MEA to stay within the fold, because they do very well by their trust. But, you know, times are changing, and, you know, money's scarce, and people do what they have to do. So, yes, there'll be resistance. It's not going to happen overnight. There may be a legal hurdle to get the cheapest possible one, but if I had to make a guess, within 5 years, a lot of towns will be doing this.
Okay, well, clearly a lot of work went into it, and thank you.
Any other questions?
Just a quick comment and a thank you to Penny and David. This was a huge undertaking. This was, being on the committee, it was a cakewalk compared to the work that the two of them put in. They pulled together the final document, and it was days and days and days of work of pulling together, you know, reams of paper into a very readable report. And as a committee member, I appreciate it. And as a school board member, thank you so much for taking the time to pull it into something understandable and cogent. And I appreciate it.
Thank you, and thank you, Mary, for all the work you did on it. But one of the things, quickly, Mike McGovern gave, when we gave this presentation, last night, gave a wonderful speech about the quality of the municipality, the quality of the town, of the school, and how people, some people, and he expressed it as a minority of people, constantly were complaining about the metrics, and you weren't being comparing yourself to the metrics, you weren't doing anything good to say. It was a very wonderful speech. I wish I could do it as well, but I believe the same is true for the schools. We do a great job, we deliver a great product at a cost below all of our comparable towns. All of the various metrics, cost per student, were cheaper than the other towns, and for the audience, I think our school board does exactly the same thing. We deliver a very, very good product. I think we are very close to delivering an A product at an A price. And we do it through a lot of hard work by teachers, a lot of hard work by administration, a lot of hard work by volunteers like this board and by committees like we're on. And I can't say enough for the people on this committee, or say enough for what the school board does, and I would urge you to remember that on things like this, and for things in general, this was my opportunity to beat Kathy Ray about making this speech, because she and I both heard the wonderful speech and wanted to repeat it equally for the schools. We have to stop thinking about the 12 to 14 people who bombard us with, get rid of that millions of dollars in waste, get rid of this, get rid of the police department, get rid of special ed, get rid of this. We have to realize that we really do a great job, and our teachers do an unbelievable job. We know what they do, and we deliver a great product. And this year, we have a tough time, but as we all know, with some revenue changes, we may be able to continue our great product. And we should take a lot of pride in it. I have a lot of pride in our teachers and our administrators, and I should look both ways for our administrators, but it's a wonderful job, and we have to keep our eye on the ball. That is our job, produce an A product and an A price. The municipal side does it, and the school side does it, and we got to keep doing it. And if the naysayers can find a better way, we'll listen. Until they do, so I'm outside, I'm a citizen now. I want to thank all of you for what you're doing and what you're about to do over the next 2 or 3 weeks. But Mike's speech was inspiring, and I'm not even close to doing the job he did. But I want you to understand that that's the way most people in this town feel.
Thank you, David. May I ask, is this document available on the website?
It's on the
It's on the council website. I assume that it's...
Okay, yeah, so it's on the town website.
Yeah.
Correct. And they asked a variety of questions, which...
David, I'm really sorry, but we've got
okay.
to
I'm
go
just saying
move on.
That if we have to change this, because questions, we'd glad...
Okay, well, I'd like to suggest that we all take some additional time to review it and then discuss it at our finance committee meeting as to any next steps.
Thank you.
Thank you.
The council is going to be discussing it on Thursday night at the first finance committee meeting and then make a determination of where to go from here. But I think
for the municipal side,
the whole and then the whole conversation that should there be collaboration or coordination with the school.
Okay. Our workshop is not until the 23rd.
Understand that this committee tried to make it very clear it's up to this board and the municipal board to make those decisions.
Right.
We're just making recommendations.
Thank you.
Thank you, Penny. Thanks, David.
Okay. Alan.
Yes.
Superintendent's budget update.
Yes. First, as you notice, I took my watch off. And so I will watch my time very carefully. I am going to do this fairly briefly because tonight is only to give you the budget, but I just want to talk about some pieces, particularly since there are three new board members here, also two students here who probably haven't dealt with this document before, and some of you who haven't dealt with it for many years. So I do have a few slides, and just basically what these slides will do is give you a quick overview. It will not take you into the content of this budget itself. That will happen on Monday night. And so all of you have the booklet tonight. We'll tell you that my understanding is it is all on the website. We hope, as we're having this meeting, it will be open to the public so that it will be available. But before I even begin, I, like David did a few minutes ago, have to say thank you to certain people who've worked there, who've worked very, very hard to do this. I thank the administrators who have had to have more meetings than they ever wanted to have with me in the last 4 months as we've worked our way through budget, and through different scenarios in the budget to try to get to the bottom line of where we are. Obviously, I can't even say enough about Pauline and the amount of work she does on this and the accuracy that she does, including within the last 3 hours, to get the final money that we have right now. And it doesn't mean tomorrow won't be different. And I also thank Gary, who set up our new site. It's a much easier site to use. I think any of you in the public who go to use it will find it much quicker to use, much easier to find specific documents, etc., as you go through. So if you'll bear with me, I will go through this very quickly, but I just want everyone in the community to understand the work that has been done in order to formulate this budget plan. So, with that in mind, I will ask my computer to be nice to me. There we go. All right. So what I'm going to talk about very quickly is the guidelines for building this budget proposal. I think you've heard me say this before, and I'll say it again. This is my 42nd year in education, and I think this has been by far the most difficult year I've ever seen financially, both from locally. I know. I said it last year, and it's even worse this year. Both from a local perspective, a state perspective, and a federal perspective, it has been very, very difficult, and the changing picture has been difficult. One of the things that we have worked on very carefully, one of the things we do, and we always do, and the administrators and I have done, is keep a very close eye on what our mission and vision are, because those are keys to what we're doing. We are different than other agencies around the states as education agency, because our product is young people. The product that we produce is the learning that happens in the classrooms. So fortunately, about 6 years ago, this community got together and they developed a mission and vision statement. I won't read that to you, but I do provide it for you, and I do have copies of all of these slides, I might add, so that you have them to refer back to as you read the budget. But it talks about the type of work we need to do with our students in order to help them move ahead. It also talks about our beliefs about students and learning. And what do we believe about that? About all students learning, about all students should be challenged and supported in their learning. All students have abilities and talents that are worthy of being recognized and developed, and so on. These are extremely important. But in order to make that happen, We must also have teachers and the active teaching that is both collaborative, reflective, and professional, that teachers need to understand and address the different learning styles of their students, and our community expects values and supports excellence in education. And certainly, I feel that's happening here in Cape Elizabeth. We also look at our learning community. Our learning community can be compared with some of the districts, but it can also be seen as a unique learning community because you have many young people who are truly challenged in what they want to do and how they want to do it. We also look at, 2 years ago, Trish Brigham and a group put together two sets of goals for this system, also based on some community work. The first one, the district will ensure that learning needs of all students are met, and it talks specifically about some of the things we should look at. Some of these things have played out in the work that we have done around curriculum assessment and instruction. Some of them have played out in classroom work. I look at each of your schools and some of the things you have done in the last few years to really accentuate what happens in the classroom. But we also recognize that as a district, we will only be successful when we attract, retain, develop, and supervise the best possible staff for Cape Elizabeth schools. Now, many of you have already had some discussions with your principals. Many of you know this has been a very difficult year to do some of this. But as the time has gone on, as the change in monies have happened with the state level, we are hoping that we will be quite successful. We will have some problems, we admit that, but the board and we'll work on those problems as we work our way through the budget. Our planning. Early in our starting to plan, we looked at what was happening at the state level. Several of us went to Augusta, and what we came back with is the very clear possibility that we could be shot $1.7 million. That was overwhelming for me, and it was overwhelming for my administrators as we began to look at this. However, the landscape began to change. First, on February 1st, we got a report provided to us by the State Revenue Allocation Department that we were only going to lose $40,032. Now, when I say only lose, I would much rather only lose $40,032 than $900,000. So that was a change for us. Then, on March 3rd, we received another document which told us that instead of losing $40,032, we would be gaining $252,512. Again, a changing picture. I think if you go out into communities around us and say you're from Cape Elizabeth, they're going to say, hey, why did you get all that money when we lost so much money? But we were very fortunate, and part of it had to do with our property value here in Cape Elizabeth. We recently got information back, David mentioned it a few minutes ago, with health insurance, where we had estimated it would be 10%, it has come in at 2%. And you remember last year, we estimated it at 18%, and it came in at 0%. So we've had two good years with that. We have also, yesterday, discovered there is a slight decrease in the ARRA money that we're getting, but we can still cover that fairly comfortably with what we're doing. The current proposal that I worked on, the one that is in this book, is based on a meeting that I had with you on February 23rd, where you gave me some direction. You talked about a 0% tax increase. You also talked about developing a midpoint budget, what might have been called a 50-50 budget. Where was it? And you talked about a maintenance budget, where we would come back to where we are. We might make some changes in that, but it would still be a maintenance budget. The fourth thing you asked for was a separate list of possible proposals. If you look in your budget book, inside the cover, you'll find those possible proposals with a description of each. The administrators and I had discussed those. We decided what were the chief ones, and so those have been put in there. They are not in the budget itself because you were very clear, and I agree with you. These should not be built in the budget, but items you should be considering and looking at as we move along. The last piece in red is the changing revenues and how we have dealt with those as we have moved forward. We looked at student enrollment. I look at statistics here. You can see that on October 1st, 2009, we had 1,708 students. However, taking a look at our population today, I went back to look, we have 1,718 students in the system. Our population has dropped. but has not dropped as drastically as it has been seen around the state. We are estimating next year that we probably will have 1,687, but again, we know with people moving in and moving out, possibly with property beginning to sell again, we may have many new families in here as well. But we have had to make decisions on class sizes based on the information we have at this point. I put this in here not for you to read, because I don't think you can read it. It is so hard to read, but this is in your budget, so you can take a look at the changes in population over a period of time. You'll find that in the graphs you receive. You see the 910 populations, the 1011 estimates, and the 1112 estimates as well. Again, that is in your budget book, so you'll be able to look at them. What you will find in the book at the very beginning is my introduction to it. What I will talk about in my introduction is the developing plan, the guiding principles we used in order to get to that plan, review all components of budget areas, do some items, consider some items that needed to be looked at, and some recommendations based on recent information from the state. So those are basically in my, I think I have a 7-page introduction. Those are some of the things that you will see there as you go along. And the reason I mention that is you will find when you get into the book that every administrator for their budgets had written a summary. And those summaries are extremely important, because what they do is both look at the history, look at the present, and look at where we hope we can go and continue to go in the future. Some of the things that have influenced set choices are student educational needs. We look at every one of our students and what do they need. We look at current fixed costs. We looked at federal and state mandates that come down from the legislature and from the federal government. We looked at limited state funding. We look at class size and enrollment. We look at debt services. And we recognize that when this moves from the superintendent's budget to your budget, that's just one more step. It then goes to the town council, where they can, although they can't cut our budget, they can set a certain dollar amount. And then it finally goes to the citizens. And if you watch the calendar at all, the citizen vote will be on June 8th, when that final decision will be made. Amongst the items we considered carefully, there is a list here. Again, it is in the reports as you read them. I only put it there so you're well aware of some of the things we've talked about that include so many different components of it. I think the third one is one that I take a great deal of pride in by the CIA committee. And that's their work on the curriculum management plan, which is going to be an extremely important piece of the history as we move through this process. Another document, again hard to read, but because I want to be really clear, if you look at this document, you'll see four columns. The first column is the 2009-2010 budget. The second column is a 0% tax increase. The third column is a midpoint budget. And the fourth column is a maintenance budget. So what we have done is we have looked at each of those and how our finances will play out accordingly. And if you look at the paper that Shari has passed out or has available to everyone, it talks about these and what those mean to us as we move along. The book itself contains the introduction by me, a summary of the budget with ARR information. That's that document you just saw. It has a series of charts providing overview of important data, including school funding, fund balances, major budget changes, requested changes, chart of cost as a percentage of budget. You also see a general operating budget. The general operating budget in here is one based on the 0%, and we will continue to add or delete from that as you have your discussions about where you would like to see this budget go. And there is a narrative by each department head. And again, I ask you to please take the time to read those. There's some interesting and clear thinking that has gone into them, some research that has been put there that I think, again, points to the feeling of every one of your administrators about the school system and what they want this school system to be for the young people who go through it. So it's really important for you to see that. Items that I'm going to ask you to consider in this report is that we have some extra money. At this point, it is in contingency. And the reason it's there is because we have several issues that we will have to look at. We have possible furnace replacement at the high school. That, there is a letter about that in the CIA budget, so you can read that and see what Ernie has to say about it. We need to get ready to plan for preparation of the 2011 and 12 budget. If, from what we know right now, if it happens the way we hear, we will have lost ARRA money for 2011 and 12. This year, we got just under $1 million worth of ARRA money. So that is going to be difficult if that happens. And there is going to be a decrease in general purpose aid to education based on what the state has told us at this point in time. So those are issues we need to look at. And because we know we have spent our undesignated funds almost to zero, we need to look at how we might replenish some of those funds. In closing, I ask you to do some things. Please take the time to review each section of the book. Formulate initial questions and send copies to fellow board members, the administrators, and to me. Feel free to ask more questions in the meetings. Allow us time to ensure accurate responses. Work together to make final adjustments based on the educational needs of students and balance student needs and the financial realities. My hope is you'll find this book very helpful. It is full of information. Sometimes it's too full of information. It sometimes can be overwhelming. But I think it's important. And I think, again, as many of you know who have worked with me for the last few weeks, it has been a changing document practically every single day. So I would like to thank the people who have worked with me to get this together and to present it to you this evening. We look forward to your questions on Monday and our opportunity to answer any of those questions. Thank you very much.
Alan, very
how did
impressive.
I do?
Okay. Very well.
15 minutes.
Okay, so this evening, if you have any procedural questions about the budget process, I'll take those. We'll hold off on any substantive questions around the actual budget until our workshop on Monday.
Yeah, I guess I do. I'd like to understand a little bit, if you wouldn't mind telling me, about the workshop on Monday and the workshop on Thursday. Okay. And
Kathy, do you want to answer that question as finance chair?
Sure. Tell me what your question is, I guess.
What is the question?
what to expect.
Can you just outline the process of those meetings or the...
Sure. Yeah, I mean, what we have done in the past, and I assume we will do unless the board says we want to do something else, is we get together. I'm not sure if your folks are doing any presentations. So what we do is we've gone through the book, and then we come in and we've got everybody with us to answer questions, specifically if you've given questions in advance that require additional information, then they will have put that together. But it's basically a chance to ask all kinds of questions, have lots of discussions, because you might have a question that somebody else has. And so it's sort of a flowing type of meeting. It's open to the public. The public usually does come. We give some time at the end of the meetings, all of them, for the public to have some comments and questions. We try not to be too tight with an exact type of, 5 minutes here, 5 minutes there, because there is so much information. There needs to be a lot of chance for the board members to ask questions and work through the answers and what might need to be gathered for the following meeting. I'm not sure, am I answering your question or?
And then at what point would we begin to, as a board, make recommendations about the direction we'd like the final board budget to go? And
sure. Oftentimes, as we work on the workshops, things will come out and Ann will make some changes to his budget based on various things that might come out. And so he will potentially make some changes after we've had the budget workshops and the public hearings. We eventually get to the point where we are going to vote on the budget. And at that point in time, presumably you've had enough time to work through the budget yourself, make some determinations, and make a decision on where you would like to see the budget as an individual board member. We come and we vote on that budget in April, at the April business meeting. That's what we've set up. Right now, we have two workshops with a potential third one if there's not enough, you know, if there's continued questions and more ideas as to, you know, where are we going with this and why is this way and couldn't we look at this? Because there's a lot of that sort of goes on. And we vote on the budget. In this particular instance, we're going to have to sort of figure out, we've got three potential budgets, so I'm not sure exactly how that'll work, but bottom line is...
That's what I was thinking about.
Yeah, that's new this year, so we're going to have to sort of work through, as a board, how we're dealing with that. And you will come up with... you know, an idea at some point that, you know, I think I'm comfortable with this or that. The board gets together and it's nice if we have seven votes for a budget, but four votes carries it. And so once we've voted on the budget and we've approved it, it becomes the school board's budget.
Okay. Thank you.
Kathy?
Yeah.
It's remarkable that I'm not accessing this memory at all, considering the number of times I've done this, but when we meet as a finance committee in the budget workshops and we've asked all of our questions and we go into the discussion point, do we as a finance committee vote on a scenario, or does that happen only at our business meeting?
Well, that's a good question. You think I recall that, huh?
Because I would imagine that we would have to know,
make a recommendation to the board.
We would have to make a recommendation to the board specifically for the reason that we would need to know what the tax impact is, so have all those numbers for us available at our
And I do recall, Alan, what we did last year.
What I remember doing is in those meetings, what you do is you take just a poll of where people seem to stand on it, which also offers us the chance to take a look at our documents and begin to work those out. I don't think your final vote can come before the official meeting unless you set that meeting as an official meeting, but that you do kind of do a poll around the room to get a sense of where everyone is at that point in time.
Yeah, I think you're right. Thank you for having the memory that Rebecca and I seem to not have.
So does that help clarify?
Yes.
Okay. Thank
you. If I could just add one more thing to that. One of the reasons I stress reading the reports from all the administrators, several years ago we used to take nights and every administrator would do a presentation, usually 20 minutes to a half an hour to 45 minutes. The decision was that that was an enormous amount of time taken, but you just couldn't get discussion. So they have worked very carefully at building a clear picture in here, written picture. You will see some, I just turned a page in the high school one, and you'll see Jeff has this diagram called Cape High School Pyramid of Intervention. I'm sure some of you are going to want to ask questions about that, and so you'll have the opportunity to give Jeff a chance to answer those questions at that time.
Any other questions about procedure or process? I actually have just a couple of things. Please look for the community services budget in this book, because we did decide at our last finance committee meeting that we were going to have the community services presentation made to the board. So if you have questions for Janet about the community services, please include that in your questions, as you would similarly to any of the buildings, and she will answer those questions at our workshops. I do understand that Kathy has spoken with the finance chair of the town council, Sarah Lennon, and they're made aware of our approach, and we have not heard back as to whether there's any concerns, but we are going to proceed forward in this fashion. Secondly, Alan, is the loss of the adjustment in the ARRA money addressed in this book?
It will show up in the diagram itself. We've shown that.
Okay. So we'll be able to identify what change was made from 2 days ago or a day ago. And then lastly, I would just like to make a comment, because I know Alan made a reference to this earlier about if other communities would say, how did you manage to get money this year when
so many of us are dealing with substantial cuts this year. I would just remind ourselves and the audience that last year we experienced a rather significant cut, while other districts' cuts were rather smaller at least, and some actually got increases. So it's hard to remember that we were suffering much earlier than these other communities were. So it is a tad uncomfortable to be getting an increase in this environment, but we need to remind ourselves that we've been operating under some challenges for a number of years, including the spending cap during more robust times. So I think that's it for my comments.
I have one question.
Yes.
Is the money number going to change again? Are we done? Is it fine? It is not
final until the state legislature has voted on the budget, and that is supposed to happen at the end of April, which is after our vote on the budget.
Okay, and then what happens?
Then what happens? If they change it or if they don't change it?
Right. If they change, if they give or take money? We just do this process again?
No.
I think probably what you'll find is
adjustment.
The chances of it passing will be fairly certain. Okay. I think the things that I'm worried about right now is 100 and what 1,000 was that we got for the penalties money, which could be taken away from us at that point in time. Mm-hmm. I think that's the biggest issue out there, and we aren't sure where that's going to happen. That 100 and what was it, 15 or 50? I can't remember which it was.
115.
And that is included in our budget. So if we do lose that, that will be an issue we'll have to do.
So the word adjustment is the what will happen. We'll make adjustments in the budget and vote on it.
Yeah, we'll have to make adjustments within the budget. We cannot go back.
Thank you.
You look puzzled about the penalties. Did you?
No,
Alan, do you have anything in your back pocket in case that happens? Any idea of
I really don't at this point in time. What I'm hearing from people who I've talked with recently is it looks like that probably will stay in the budget. I think I heard that the governor is trying to find some other monies to take care of those possibilities at this point in time.
Yeah.
So I'm hoping that it won't be touched after all of us have come to start with budgets.
Yeah. I heard the same thing in terms of addressing the penalties issue, that would try to come from a different pool of money.
And do you want to just explain so people understand what the penalties issue is?
So we're discussing penalties because of the consolidation law that was passed in the state of Maine. Those districts that did not consolidate are assessed a higher local assessment rate for taxes, local taxes, than those schools that did consolidate or were exempted, which then resulted in those districts that did meet the requirements received a little bit of higher allocation than those districts that did not. And there is some discussion about some language problems with the law, in particular those districts that are unable to find partners are still under this law going to be assessed a penalty. And there's other things like that. So I know that there's a good deal of discussion about trying to rectify that language problem. But from what I read in the paper, the governor has said that if these penalties are removed, that he will look for financing of that from another pool of money.
Just for clarification, for anyone who doesn't know, we are exempted.
Yes,
we are exempted. Right now we are.
Right.
And we will remain that way because we're.
I have a quick question. I've looked through this real quickly. Is there a place in here that you could tell me where there is the description of on a zero budget what we would have to cut and who they are? Not necessarily who they are. What are the costs and benefits and so forth? That, looking quickly, I couldn't find it.
There is a chart on. I think I have a marker here. It's on pages 11 and 12 in the front of the book.
Okay, I looked at that chart. I see the description of the person, But what I think we had asked for was a description, not just of the entity or the thing or the person, whatever, but a description of what the value was as well as what we're giving up.
You'll find that in the descriptions that the administrators wrote.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you, David. Any other questions? Okay, great. Thank you very much, Alan. Moving on to new business 7B, consideration to approve the athletic equipment storage shed paid for and maintained by the Cape Elizabeth Little League at Moulton Field.
I think Jeff is speaking.
Just recently, this is a proposal and obviously the first step in this process. Just recently approached by the Cape Elizabeth Little League board to build a storage shed, and there's a picture of what that would look like, similar to the ones at Lions Field. Again, this is a storage, so this wouldn't be a snack bar. For the Moulton Field, and which is the middle school baseball field, location would be right by the batting cage, and they understand that this is a process and it's going to take some time and it won't happen immediately. I think I've discussed this with Alan and Mike McGovern that we'll put projects on hold until we have accumulated a number to submit those, because it is a pretty costly to move these things forward. So they're well aware of that, and they're just looking to get this process started.
Okay. So do I have questions for Jeff?
Well, I have a question about exactly what he wants us to approve. Is it just to start considering it? Because we don't have enough detail here to approve or not approve anything.
I think in order for this to move forward to the next phase, we're looking for your approval to bring it to the town council, planning board.
The process has been in the last few years that what we do is we get the proposal, we look at it, and then move it to the town council so it can go to them and then go to the
planning board.
Yes, thank you. And then if there are any questions that need to come back, like you did tonight, they can come back at that point in time. But it really is just a vehicle, because we don't want to be the stalling point to just get it to move ahead from there.
So before we finally sign off, we'll see a plan of what it is and what will happen. Okay, thank you.
Like we did with the other one tonight.
The town will actually put together a plan for the structure.
Any other questions for Jeff? Do I have a motion? Somebody?
I'll move.
To approve?
To approve the athletic storage shed paid for and maintained by the Cape Elizabeth Little League in Moulton Field.
Is there a second?
Second.
Mary, thank you. Any discussion? Okay, all those in favor? 6-0. Thank you, Jeff. Okay, next is consideration to approve a second consecutive leave of absence for the 2010-2011 school year for PONCO staff member Holly Forsyth. Tom, do you want to?
Good evening. These requests have come up from time to time during my tenure as principal at Pond Cove, and each time I've tried to consider pros and cons, and I don't find a lot of cons. It really is literally an extension of the need that the people on leave had. It's extension for another year, and I don't see any educational harm in doing it. The few times it's happened before, the people who have been away for 2 years have kind of been revived, because it takes a little bit to come back and re-enter. They're not quite sure what grade level they'll be in, so there's an induction process at the end. So I would fully support it. I have before, and I would support this one.
Thank you, Tom. Are there any questions for Tom? Okay, do we have a motion?
I move that we approve the second consecutive leave of absence for Holly Forsyth.
For the 2010-2011 school year?
For 2010-2011.
Second.
Well, very good. Thank you. Any discussion? Kathy?
Yes, I'm going to take the same position that I took the last time that we had a leave of absence request for a second year. And I can't support that, and it's not about the individual. I'm saying I don't support it for anyone. By law, we're required to give 12 weeks for a family medical leave. And we've elected in the past, and I think pretty consistently given up to 1 year leave of absence. But after that, I feel it's in the best interest of students to have a full-time employee. And I also think that it's in the best interest of the employees to be able to have a full-time job that they can depend on and not have a full-time sub. So I see it as a twofold. I see that the employees need to know that they have a job. So if you've got somebody substituting or an employee out there who's looking for a position, we're delaying that that event for another year. And I think that the students need to have a full-time, consistent teacher. Now, I know we've had, and the discussion has been, that we've had good full-time subs. And I'm saying, let's take it to the next level. So I also personally feel that the longer an employee is on leave, the less likely they will return. That's been my experience in the business world, but you know, that may not be. So again, I'm not talking about the individual. I realize it affects the individual. But the last time this came up as a second year leave of absence, I voted against it, and I will do so tonight. And unless something changes in my mind, I will do that consistently for any second leave that's requested. So.
Okay, thank you, Kathy.
Yep.
David?
Actually, Kathy, I think, makes some very good points, and I would ask Tom, is there something special, and I will have to admit my son had Holly and probably still has a crush on her. Hopefully that won't get recorded. But is there something special about Holly that it offsets the concept of a teacher, all the points that Kathy Ray stated?
I think we need to be very careful about making those statements in public.
Yeah. I think we're getting into a personnel matter, so we need to keep it at a level that's more policy level than it is specific.
Okay, I'll rephrase level. My question then.
Please.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
On balance, Kathy Ray has raised some general questions in general about the concept of having people on two-year leaves. In this instance, the costs and problems she has stated, are you comfortable that it's offset by the benefits of extending it for a year?
Thank you, David.
Yes, I am.
Yes, I am. And in my experience, the people who are granted leave do come back. Yes, and we do have full-time teacher professionals. The economic...
I couldn't hear this. Sorry. Oh.
Sorry.
The staffing and economic, there's been a change. So we have full-time teachers ready to... It's not as if we have to hire a sub, is my point. We have people ready to go because of the economic situation and the layoffs we have had before. Am I drifting too far for you?
No. The question was the benefits of extending this for a year outweigh the costs? And I think your answer is yes.
Yes.
It's just said in the audience, but put on the record. And you think that the second reason is you believe that you have full-time people that can take care of it for this additional year. And third, it's your experience, at least in Pond Cove, that the people generally do come back.
Yes. Refreshed.
Sorry to cross-examine.
May I step down?
Yes, you may.
I have no more questions.
I never had a witness ask me to pull another question, but.
Okay.
I actually like to speak. Oh, did you have? Sorry, go ahead.
That's okay. Kathy, I remember your point being made last year, and I do think you make some good points that we should discuss. And I thought last year we were going to take it into policy because it had been, it's been our policy to, and maybe I'm wrong, correct me if I'm wrong, really. Okay, Rebecca's
Sorry, I'm
correcting
shaking
me
my head
by shaking her head.
It's a contract issue. It's actually in the contract.
Okay.
Yeah, so it's not a policy issue. It's a contractual issue.
Okay. Well, we had talked about readdressing that because in the past we had, it's been customary that we approve the second year. So I remember last year we approved at least one position for that reason, but it's certainly, you bring up points that should probably be fleshed out a little more.
John?
Well, I'm speaking as always as an educational newbie, but former board member Karen Burke shared with the board recently, I thought an enlightening article from a Harvard educator about what makes an ideal school. And one of the points he made had to do with employee leaves. And this may be may not get speak to the issue of whether it's a first or a second leave. He was clear in saying that in order to create an environment where people feel that they're working where they want to work and for the reasons that they want to work, that it was important for administrators and boards to grant leaves when requested, and that it made I think a similar point to Tom's, which is that people often come back from these leaves refreshed and reinvigorated and recommitted to their career. So for that reason, I would support it.
Anybody else?
Can I just clarify one point? And I agree, and I just don't know if I said it clearly, but I agree that a one-year leave of absence is a good idea. What I don't agree with is the second. So I just wanted to clarify. Okay.
Anything else? All those in favor? 5-1. All those opposed? Sorry. Thank you. Okay, next. Oh, my goodness. Consideration to approve the following extracurricular position recommendations. You know what? Alan, I'm going to say that this list is on the website for anybody to access. It's rather lengthy. So unless there's anything in specifically that you would like to talk about, we'll just ask if there's a motion, and then we can get into discussion. Is that okay with you?
Oh, definitely.
Okay. Do I have a motion?
I make a motion to talk about I'm not on the same page. I make a motion to approve the list of staff members for extracurricular activities to be discussed.
Excellent.
Thank you.
Thank you. Well done.
Thank you.
Is there a second?
Second.
Okay. Yes. Discussion?
Is Jeff the one to answer the questions? Is he left?
She's right there.
But, he wished he'd left.
this day seems to have been about you, Jeff. I don't have any questions with who you've picked. The ones I know, I think, are excellent. The ones I don't know, I have great confidence in your judgment. My question is there something missing? Is there something in the 8, 9, is there anything being left out that I obviously can't see on this chart? Is there anything being left out versus last year?
So I'll just point out there aren't any new positions in this proposal. It is, there's one new hire.
Is there any position that existed last year that's not on this list? In other words, is there somebody, by approving this list, are we cutting out JV ping pong or something?
Yeah. No, the one new hire to that would be the freshman baseball coach. But there wouldn't be a difference from last year's spring coaches aside from that one change.
And so we're basically offering the same quantity?
Same quantity and staff.
Thank you.
Any other questions or discussion? Okay. All those in favor? Thank you. Consideration to approve the proposed Dartmouth Model UN field trip for April 9th to 11th, 2010. Jeff Schiff.
Just very briefly, first of all, I have to apologize for unintentionally misleading the board the last time I was here speaking on behalf of a World Affairs trip, because I didn't remember that this trip was happening as well. I think I mentioned that I thought there was just one more trip, and I think there's one more after this one. I'd like to think that at some point, with all the activities that go on in the high school, that I could be on top of all of them, but I am not. This is a trip that the program has done. It is an overnight trip. The proposal is chaperoned adequately within school board policy guidelines. The cost is $250 per student, and it's a great opportunity for the kids.
Any questions for Jeff? Okay, do I have a motion? Kathy?
I move that we approve the Cape Elizabeth High School World Affairs Council trip for the dates of April 9th through the 11th to Dartmouth College in Hanover, New Hampshire.
Okay, hold on a second. World Affairs versus Model UN.
Oh, I apologize. Do I have the wrong one?
World Affairs to the Model UN.
It's a group of kids on the World Affairs to a Model UN event, okay, is the way it is.
Sorry.
Those two.
That's okay.
Yeah.
Okay. I think that's fine. Is there a second?
Second.
Mary. Okay, discussion? All those in favor? 6-0. Mm-hmm. Thank you, Jeff. Okay, consideration to approve the execution of a tax-exempt lease purchase agreement for an 8-passenger van with a purchase price of $25,325.
What I will do is speak to this briefly. When we discussed it, I believe, at the Finance Committee meeting, if I'm not mistaken, at that point in time, we were not sure if we had three bids. We did have three bids for it from three different companies. This bid for the $25,325 is the lowest of the three bids. It has attached to it the letter from Janet and Pat Fowler about the need for the van, which you saw, I believe, at the Finance Committee meeting. And it also has the description, which I think you got at that meeting also. It shows the picture and the description of the van. So, but I think the major concern you had at that point in time was three bids, and we did have them from three auto dealers here, in the two in the Portland area and one from Augusta.
Any questions for Alan?
Yes.
Is this van for the use of the school department only, or do we share this with the town?
Janet?
The van that we're requesting is used by community services and the school department.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Well,
I'm slightly concerned about the vote to be adopted, mainly because I know something about lease purchase agreements.
Okay, but that's a discussion probably. So if you have a question for Alan.
I was going to ask a question, but okay.
Okay, no, I'm sorry.
I don't know whether it's discussion or question, but I have a question about this. I'm not clear on what it is we're doing. A lease, you usually know the term of the lease and how much you're paying per year, but the total lease payments and those type of questions I have. Okay.
Yeah, let's move it and then we can have discussion. Is there a motion, please?
I have a question.
John has a question.
I'm sorry, John. But
it can happen in discussion.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay, do I have a motion? Somebody.
I move that we approve the execution of a tax-exempt lease purchase agreement for an 8-passenger van with a purchase price of $25,325.
Is there a second?
Second.
David. Okay. Discussion.
I have several questions, and it's because in this vote that's in our packet, it seems odd to say you lease something before a purchase price of $25,000. you lease something for a period of time, you have a total amount of lease payments, and then at the end, you have the ability to purchase for a particular price. So I'm very confused about the vote. If we, is it, because normally you vote on, am I making myself clear, that normally you vote on a lease with a certain number of things, and then at the end, you decide whether you want to buy it or not. So I don't know how much this lease is going to cost us.
On a yearly basis.
On a yearly basis, how many years it is, and what is the purchase price at the end of the lease. I'm guessing this $25,000 would be if we bought it right now instead of leased it, because that can't be the purchase price at the end of a lease.
Pauline, can you come up and...
Are you sick yet of answering my question?
No. The purchase price as you have it there is $25,325.
Is that if we purchased it instead of leased it?
This is a municipal lease purchase. It is like a loan that we pay over a five-year period. The interest rate was 4.1%, so our payments on a yearly basis is about $5,500 for 5 years. So at the end of the lease, we'll have paid $27,495.
And then in the end of the lease, do we own the vehicle?
Yes, we do.
Okay, I, for whatever it's worth, I think the vote needs to be slightly reworded for it to make it work. I don't have any problems with it now that I understand it.
Pauline, you've had a number of these, so do you understand?
The language of the lease vote was put together by our attorney.
Okay, any other questions?
I was going to say that it's not the first time I've seen an attorney draft something inaccurately, but that I'm not going to cry about it.
John, did you have a question?
No.
No? Okay. Anybody else? Discussion? Okay. All those in favor? Others opposed?
And I want to say my opposition is not for acquiring a van. It's because I think the vote is inaccurate.
Okay, thank you. Okay, 7G, consideration to approve the superintendent's recommendation for contract renewals for 2010-11 for administrators employed 2 years or less.
Okay, yes. I want to be sure we are clear on this because I know there was some major questions before. These two employees, Janet Hoskin as the Community Service Director and Jeff Thorak, the Athletic Administrator, This is the end of their second year. I have evaluated them several times during the year. I'm in the process of doing this final evaluation, which will be done in June. But what I have to do is get permission to give them a renewal of their contract for the 2010-2011 year so that we can move forward with that. I have not normally given evaluations to the board to read. It is usually dependent upon my ability to do the evaluations, but I know there are a lot of questions before, so I thought I better get this on here and see what the questions might be so we can move ahead. But I will say to you both that both of these people are extremely fine employees who have done an excellent job, many times above and beyond what they had to do in order to take care of the issues of the district.
Any questions for Alan?
Alan, I have a question. Are you recommending a one-year contract?
Well, you know, it's funny. I'm looking at that. At this point in time, I am, but I just, as I was starting to say that, I remember the contract for administrators. After the second year, it is a three-year contract.
Right.
And so probably I had not had a chance to talk with Andrea, but it probably should be a 2010 to 2013.
Yes. That's why I asked
the
question.
Yes, I'm glad you did. I didn't realize it until I just read that and saw that.
I'm just thinking of for consistency purposes.
Definitely. Oh, sorry. Chair.
I have a procedural question, I guess. In looking at the budget, if the job descriptions change because I'm a not about the people, but about the job description and the fact that I don't think the job description falls into the essential eight subject areas that we need to keep primary, the curriculum, eight curriculum subject areas. Mm-hmm. So say those we have to cut extra activities that go outside of our curriculum that we're mandated to do. Would that change with that with this contract? Say we change the position, the way the school works. Would then signing this contract, how would that work for the two employees that who are not? Do you understand my question?
Yeah, I understand your question. I have an initial reaction, but I probably need to do a little more research on it.
Yep.
My initial reaction is that they are continue to be evaluated every year. They have a contract that goes for 3 years. I need to look at the, and I don't have the right book yet. I need to look at the right to the bottom line of their contract, but my understanding was we give them a contract for 3 years, but they are evaluated on a yearly basis, and therefore we can make decisions otherwise. But I don't want that to be cast in stone because right. I really do need to look that up.
Well, it must happen with other.
I also think we need to be clear that we're not approving a negotiated contract.
Right.
What we are saying is that we plan to continue to keep them on. They are no longer probationary and that we will renew the contract. So that is the extent of this vote.
I couldn't quite hear that.
Regardless?
We are not voting on an actual contract. We are required by law to notify the state of Maine if we plan on continuing their employment. And so that's what we're doing tonight.
So I guess that sort of led to my question. If Alan's doing one more final review, let's say something odd comes up and he decides to not actually enter into a contract with them, have we already approved that he enter into a contract with them? It's a very oddball situation.
Yes.
The state
He's
required.
With this
I read this
year.
I was going to say, because it is a state requirement that I must do something by April 1st.
But David, I think maybe if I'm understanding your question, if I can, Alan can always terminate for cause. So if you're talking about an oddball situation, it doesn't matter who the employee is. If there's a cause, he can terminate any employment as long as he takes the proper steps.
And as we all know, cause is a very difficult thing. And I happen to know these two people, and I think they're going to be excellent. I have been excellent. I've been extremely pleased with them. I know the problem's caused by state law. We have to notify them that we are going to consider. I guess it's the way the language is the motion is worded that's confusing, and caused by a law that's very confusing. But we're really allowing him to notify the state. We are approving him. There is a possibility there'll be a renewal on a 3-year basis for people that have been here for 2 years. But it's still possible that Alan might not sign the contract. So it's a very odd thing that we're voting on. Mm-hmm. If I was to draft that motion, I would have said that we approve that the superintendent continue to negotiate and that if he decides to get into it that way. Because I think Kate's question had to do with we're about to sign a contract for 3 years. Which, if we then breach it because we now want to let them out, all of a sudden we owe somebody 3 years worth of damages, where if we held off on signing the contract to actually get through this wonderful budget process, we wouldn't have a liability we would have to pay. I think that's what Kate was getting at.
Yes.
Is that correct, Kate?
Pauline, are we actually signing off on a contract for 3 years? Is that what this vote is for the state? Right. So we're not actually I don't know how to explain this, but we're not actually signing a contract for 3 years. We're just indicating to the state that we plan on employing them.
So the bottom line, I think, for everybody is that if for some reason the oddball thing happens and it's decided not to enter into a 3-year contract, by making that decision, by doing today, we don't all of a sudden incur three-year liability.
Yes, that's correct.
And I have no problem.
And can I just say something, just for clarification? I don't have to send their contracts to the state. The only person that has to be certified by the state is me. And so they are, I sign their contracts for their employment here. It isn't a state approval one way or the other.
I understood that. I was more looking at timing, and Rebecca answered it for me.
Okay. Any more questions or discussion? Okay, do we have a motion?
No.
I move to approve the superintendent's recommendation for contract renewals for 2010-2011 for administrators employed 2 years or less, which at this point in time include Janet Hossman and Jeff Thorak.
Would you make that 2013? 2010-2013?
It's, yeah. It says 2000-2000. I'll be glad to make it 2010-2013.
Thank you. Is there a second?
I'll second.
Mary? All right, discussion?
Nothing except I think they're both excellent. Mm-hmm. And I've worked with Jeff particularly a lot, and I'd be very pleased to have them stay here another 20 years.
Yeah. And I've worked with Janet and think she's outstanding as a community service representative.
Yeah. All right, all those in favor? 6-0. Thank you. Oh my gosh. Yeah. Okay. Committee reports. Is there anyone who dares to say that
and
they
Janet,
would like to?
I say the same thing about you, but I've dealt more with him lately. So.
David, I'm trying to confess.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Thank you. Seriously, if there is a committee report that really must be mentioned tonight,
I do have to mention the Wellness Committee's March Madness invitation to join, guys help me out, to Tara, to join in the spirit of laughter and, help me Tara, happiness and health as a de-stressor in the long month of March. And the wellness team has done an unbelievable job to reach K-12 to help provide opportunities for the staff to have laughter throughout the day. There's yellow stickers, there's a comedian's night. Thank
school
you very
board
much.
Meetings. Yes.
School board meetings. And I forward them to you guys. Exactly.
Does that come with a large pill I can take daily?
Well, we could all go to the comedians' night on March 19th.
11th and 25th.
Thank you. And we could. Yes.
Okay. I would just like to remind the board that in our April meeting, I will be asking the committees who are responsible for our 2010-11 board goals to report on the progress towards those goals and what the plans are. So please come prepared, because I will call on you.
Oh, you're not going to give the presentation for us?
No.
I thought we were supposed to turn.
Okay.
One other quick report, just to remind you, it is on for Thursday to meet with our representatives. We'll get an agenda out tomorrow. If people want to attend, I think that's a particularly important meeting to attend.
Thank you, David. Okay. Public comment on non-agenda items?
Man, do I hate to go last at 9:35.
Unless it's gymnastics, then it's always good to go last.
Thank you, Mr. Hillman. It occurred to me that some of the newer board members may not know that I have a day job. I pop up here periodically. My name is Dwight Ely. I do teach at the high school. Several years ago, I had the pleasure of also working as assistant principal at the high school. And a few years ago, I really drew the short straw, and I became president of the Cape Elizabeth Education Association. Last week, we met with the board, or members of the board, and I wanted to get back to the board as soon as possible because I know you are, in fact, on a very tight schedule as it relates to your budget planning process. And I want to respond to your inquiry or request that you made at that time. I grew up in a very beautiful but rural part of Pennsylvania. I attended a traditional little white church that was perpetually on the verge of financial disaster. And thus, I was schooled in the belief that the Lord loves a cheerful giver. It is with that thought in mind that I am pleased to come to the board tonight and tell you that in response to your request, the association met this afternoon, and yes, we would like very much to try to contribute to the budget difficulties the district is experiencing this year. I'll explain the details of our totally voluntary offer in a moment, but I want to begin with an expression of appreciation for the manner in which the board, and in particular, Rebecca and Kathy, approached the staff. I appreciate the fact that you recognize that the households of our school employees are feeling the pain of this recession just as much as are the households of Cape residents. Some of our colleagues' spouses have lost their jobs. Some of us have had children return to the nest with mixed blessings. And unfortunately, some of our colleagues who find it necessary to work a second job have found those hours reduced or eliminated. I also appreciate the fact that you have recognized that there are about 150 or so teachers and there are approximately 4,300 taxpayers in Cape Elizabeth, and that the issue of proportionality is an issue to be considered. However, there is, and I am pleased to say this, a very strong desire on the part of staff and teachers to contribute to finding a positive solution to this year's budget crisis. Scratch that, budget situation. Your request was indeed unusual. In the approximately 16 years that I have had the pleasure of working at CAPE, I think I have known and worked with three different boards, and I'd be delighted to tell you what those boards were someday, three different superintendents at least, and this request has never come to the faculty before. We take it seriously, and we want to respond in a positive fashion, because we do appreciate the support that the community has given the schools in the last few years. In our discussions on how we might contribute to such a solution, two criteria emerged. First, we want to contribute to a solution that we can support personally and professionally because it will ensure that we can look next year's students in the eyes and say, yes, we value you, we value your education just as much as the students who graduated last year. Second, we feel that participation on our part needs to be fair and equitable. For example, teachers could in fact fill this budget gap by themselves if all 150 of them were to take about a $6,000 pay cut. But of course that would not be fair and equitable, and fortunately no one is ever suggesting that that happen. We believe we have found a formula which meets our criteria. Like many of you, I attended the December workshop in the high school cafeteria, and in that community forum, I sat with many residents that suggested that teachers should take a furlough day. We will go you one better, because we believe a furlough day is not in the best interest of our schools. There is work to be done, and we need every day to do it. But what we will do is we will work all the days next year that are scheduled, but we will take a salary reduction up to the equivalent of a furlough day anyway. We are prepared to give you a furlough day in cash, but to work that day anyway. We don't like to call it a furlough day, because we're working it. Now, this approach meets our first criteria, that we contribute to a solution that attempts to maintain a quality program for students coming through our doors next year. We have had the benefit of glimpsing what the superintendent's budget looks like with cuts. And we believe it destroys much of the infrastructure of our school system. This gap, in our opinion, must not be closed with program cuts. To address our second criteria, one of proportionality and fairness, we are proposing to link teachers' households' contribution with the average CAPE household's contribution. You may have noted that I said we would cheerfully, and I mean that, cheerfully contribute to the equivalent of a furlough day. To ensure that our households and your households are in fact in this together, we are offering to make a contribution to the budget gap through a salary reduction that is twice the amount the average household in Cape Elizabeth is willing to contribute in additional taxes. We'll do this in order to close this budget gap and keep our schools on track. And we truly hope that you will take advantage of our offer to the fullest. Now, if my proposal leaves you confused, think of it this way. Yes, teachers cheerfully want to contribute to this furlough day in cash, but do the work anyway. But the exact amount our households will contribute will depend on what the households of Cape Elizabeth feel they need to do to maintain quality in our schools. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay. Okay. School board agenda requests. And announcements of upcoming meetings. I will just say that they are on the Cape Elizabeth Town website. And do I have a motion for adjournment?
Second.
Is there a second?
Second.
Okay. All those in favor? Thank you.